I just check that everybody can hear me? Right, I'll start again. Can I now check that everybody can hear me? Fantastic. Well, first of all, introductions. I'm Malcolm Grant. I'm the chairman of NHS England. And I wanted initially to thank everybody for coming tonight and to welcome you to this, our annual general meeting. I think it's quite remarkable that the NHS is loved so warmly across the country that so many people are willing and interested to come and engage with this board. But understand this, the AGM is still an innovation for the NHS. Last year, we held the first ever annual general meeting for the NHS. I know that many of you were here on that occasion, and I'm grateful to you for staying with us and coming back tonight. The NHS, by the way, doesn't belong to the board. The NHS belongs to the people of England. And by having an open, yeah, there's a yes, thank you very much. Yes, yes, all right, thank you. I'm fully expecting the other side of those cards at various points during the evening, but I'm so pleased to start off with the right one. But let me be very serious about this. The exercise in which we've been involved all day, and about which we'll hear some more in a moment, has been one which has been, I think, both educational, to use a neutral term, but actually quite moving for members of the board to listen to patients and the public and carers and those who are involved in the day-to-day work of the NHS, to understand what our dedicated workforce across England do well, and to understand where there are points of frustration and difficulty with patients and carers. So let me start by outlining the format for this evening's events. In a moment, I'm... Is my microphone not working? Has it been shut off by an alien force? Has somebody got a live mic?
It may make it interfere, so...
Can I... Does that help at all? Can I just check right at the back? That's where I have to check whether you can hear me right at the back. Yes, good. The yes banners are coming out twice consecutively. Well, that's fantastic. Thank you for that. The way in which we would like to do things this evening is to start with something which I know everybody will gain a great deal from, which is presentations from today's Citizens Assembly, NHS Citizens Assembly. And we will have those led by Olivia Butterworth, who I'll introduce in a moment. Secondly, there will then be the formal business of the AGM. It is not the normal blah, blah, blah. You see, there are ways in which corporates hold AGMs, in which a board sit on public display and answer questions about the chief executive's remuneration. That's not our style because, you know, we don't have shareholders. We have you. We have, of course, the public of England. We operate within a political environment and we're spending public money. And that's why I am most determined that the board of NHS England should, at its AGM, account to those who are taking an interest in our affairs. So at 6 o'clock, I will talk again. I will be followed by Simon Stevens, our chief executive, and then our chief financial officer, Paul Bauman, will outline to you the accounts which we are presenting to you tonight. After that, I will have an open question and answer session, and I'll outline some proposed rules of engagement before we go into that part of this evening's proceedings. So, without more ado, I'm delighted to introduce Olivia Butterworth and to ask her to facilitate the next phase of this evening's event. Olivia, please, over to you.
Thank you. and we've had some 250 people from every bit of the country involved in these conversations, and these four citizens are going to try and reflect some of those conversations that those 250 people have had today, and that's quite nerve-wracking. So before they do that, I'm going to look to the board, the executive directors who were part of those conversations, to give us their reflections, what they've heard today, and then we're going to try and turn it to a bit of a conversation about, so what next, what does that actually mean? And our citizens are going to try and reflect back whether or not that feels like a fair reflection and something that they can connect with in terms of whether they've been heard or not. So I'm going to look to Tim first, who's the National Director for Patients and Information, to give us his reflections on a conversation that he was part of around self-care and personalisation.
Yeah, actually I'll stand up. So at the root of this, and I suspect at the root of many of the other sessions, was a fundamental issue that we've all got, which is about making sure that people and patients and professionals have a real voice in the design and delivery of local services. And this was about giving people real control when they want it of their own care, making sure that they were able to express things when they went well, when they went badly, and to ensure that we had real transparency in the way in which the local health service operated, and not just proper kind of accountability, but meaningful, real, personal response to needs in local communities. So that's sort of broadly that was the overarching theme, I think, and I'll be interested to see if you know colleagues here thought that was the case. But there were some specific things that I think NHS England will absolutely need to really focus on, and I hope we will do so. The first of those was recognising that this is a truly communal endeavour. Our NHS is everybody's NHS, and in that context. There are some communities that I don't think were very good, and I think many of the voices in the group I was in would have said the same thing. We're not very good at sort of offering them the support they need, and in particular, carers was the focal point for many of the conversations. And what we heard there was that NHS England, we were asked, must give people, i.e. professionals and others, the permission to train carers, to support carers, to recognise their value in the process of delivering care. And that's not just about recognising that they're real assets for patients that they're looking after, but also because we need to care for the carers. And that was a really strong message that came through that session. So in a way, unleashing the power of people and particularly focusing our efforts on those people who are caring seems to be a really important thing that we can do something about. And I think we can commit to making that, you know, much, much more real. The second big area, and I'm slightly rushing through, but we've got the excellent graphic on the wall there that gives perhaps a more detailed summary of what was said. The second area that I took away anyway was why doesn't the NHS operate to the same standard we're used to in the rest of our lives, a kind of giving us the advantages that digital technology offer. We have mobile phones, we're able to do all sorts of things for ourselves, we're able to take control, and the NHS just does not offer us the same opportunity when we want it at the same scale. And there was a big ask around making apps more useful to patients, for example. Actually, the NHS deciding which apps were safe and good and making some level of recommendation about that to the public, helping people find digital services when they want to. So there was a piece there about technology, and again, I think we can take that away and do something about that. And then finally, I think there was a consensus around the vital importance actually of this kind of meeting, and more for those who were here earlier, the importance of NHS Citizen as a means of creating a kind of a conversation which needs to be ongoing and real for all of us. And in that context, again, a commitment to really work hard on learning the lessons of today, what NHS Citizen has told us, and to come back with ideas shared across the community about how we can truly build voice into the way NHS England operates and how we can collectively learn and work together better. Thank you.
So some real commitments to actually taking action, and I think we might come back to you about what some of those tangible actions might be. Ian, I'm going to look to you next. So Ian Dodge is a new National Director to NHS England, whose job title I can't remember, so perhaps you could remind us.
Thank you, Olivia. Ian Dodge, I'm Director of Commissioning Strategy in NHS England, and I've just been let out of a dungeon in the Department of Health where I've been locked up for the last 20 years. I'm delighted to be here today, and I was in a conversation about access to services, and I heard a lot of frustration from citizens around the problems that some of our most marginalized people in society have in accessing care, whether it's people who are deaf, people from black and minority ethnic groups, whether it's gypsies, a whole raft of people who we know tend to find it harder to access normal services, and then when they do access those services, tend to use them less well and receive less of them than more pushy middle-class, white middle-class people. So I think that message came across loud and clear. There was also, though, and this gave me grounds for hope, a lot of energy and desire from people, particularly those who were working in voluntary sector organizations, to say, actually, some of the solutions are with us. And some of this is about mindset change. How do we move away from the sense that the only way in which value can be added to people's health and healthcare is by professionals providing that care? How can we get more involved? How can we have a different conversation? Help with the access issues, help with the care issues. And I think an understanding that it's not that GP practices and hospitals are willfully failing to engage their communities effectively. It's that they're really busy and under a lot of pressure. And so there was a really big question about how can we get to a place where there is a better dialogue and a better conversation between people that are buying and people that are providing care and citizens and the communities that they serve. And I think we don't know what the right answers to that are, but we know that there's a lot more that needs to be done. And in terms of what we do, I think it's incumbent on us as the board members of NHS England to think about what this means in terms of our own behavior. So in the 2 months I've been in NHS England, speaking very candidly, there's probably been only two occasions, of which today is one, where actually I've had long conversations with citizens rather than just conversations with kind of fellow people, technocrats in the NHS system. And there's something about actually my own behavior and the behavior of people that work for me. I think there's something about our strategy and what we say. So we're planning to produce a forward view for the NHS over the next 5 years in the autumn. And there's something about how we then work with clinical commissioning groups and boards of NHS organizations to encourage them to engage more effectively with their communities. Thank you.
So real theme coming through about using and working with and alongside people and the assets in our communities, and recognizing that if we do things differently, we can connect things up better for people. You talked a lot about harder to reach groups, and I wonder, Barbara Haken, if I can look to you to feed back on quite a specific conversation around transgender people and where that got to.
Thanks, Olivia. And hello, everybody. Yes, I was in a group today that were talking about the services that we have for patients with transgender issues, gender dysphoria. And of course, a lot of the individuals in that group themselves had gender dysphoria, or they were carers or parents or relatives of such individuals. The first thing that struck me, to be honest, was that we really could do much better. We could provide much better services for those individuals. But what really overwhelmed me in the room is that despite that, everybody there was nice, kind, pleasant to me. There could have been recriminations. that the services weren't good enough, and all sorts of suggestions about what we could, we had lots of ideas about what we could do, but all said in such a way that was so nice and so respectful. So I want to say thank you to all of you for that. But what I want to say to that group of people and to everybody, would that I had a magic wand that would make every contact in the NHS that we had with our patients as pleasant and courteous as the contacts that we had in that room today, because that was the other big message that was coming out of that group, was that the first problem that they had was that people didn't treat individuals the way that we would all want to be treated ourselves, and we really, really absolutely have to do something about that. And I think that's been a message out of today. It's not just about listening, which is vital and important, but it's about being nice, it's about courtesy, dignity and respect. A lot of the issues that came out were about general practice and that first and absolutely vital contact that patients have with their general practitioner. I was a GP myself for 20 years before I moved over to the dark side of management, as some would say. But, you know, believe me, both absolutely invaluable things to do to support patients to get a better service. But whilst we all know that there are lots of really brilliant GPs who are giving patients a really great service, there were also stories that none of us would be happy about. And even where the GPs were really, really determined to do the best they could for patients, these patients, there was evidence that actually information, knowledge and easy access to next steps was so difficult for them. So I think out of that, I need to make a commitment to do a couple of things. Firstly, to work with those who are involved in GP education, the Royal Colleges and various others, to say, for this particular group of individuals, how can we make sure that GPs have readily accessible information? And maybe how can we find some middle ground? How can we find some people who are more expert and can support people locally without them always having to travel a very long distance? They may have to do that for very specialist services, but how can we find something that bridges that gap? So that would be the first part in terms of the early GP services. We then went on to talk about the more specialised services, the very specialised end of these services. And again, I took a lot from that, which will help me in terms of the things I do across a full range of specialised services. Those services which are for patients or individuals who have less common issues or disorders, and to which we have to pay particular attention because it is so much more difficult for them to have a voice. I heard about a really good clinical reference group, which is looking at what the best nature of the care could be, and with a good stakeholder group of patients, carers, individuals who were working with them. And there was some concern about whether we'd be able to maintain that group and particularly stakeholder support. So again, something else I'll take away is to go and look at that and find out how we can make sure that action and that, you know, that vital connection keeps going. And then the final thing to take away really is just the inequalities that services such as this, if they're not really the best they can be, how they can exacerbate inequalities, and how not only do we need to look at the general services for patients or individuals who have one issue, but actually to look at them as a whole person and look at the aspects of their lives. So therefore, particularly in this group, individuals with gender dysphoria who are from black and minority ethnic groups, or children, adolescents, the services for children, adolescents, and particularly as they transfer to being adults, were deeply worrying in terms of letting individuals down. So again, to take that away, because every individual deserves the rights that are in the NHS constitution, and we need to work really hard to make sure that everybody gets those rights, and that the inequalities that we all know about are addressed. Thank you.
So thanks very much, Barbara. Again, another theme around equalities, but particularly around stigma and how we challenge stigma and how we improve that communication flow and really connect with people to really understand them. Bruce Keogh, I'm going to come to you next. You had some conversations this afternoon around mental health services. I wonder if you'd like to give us your reflections.
Thanks very much. And It's 6 o'clock on a Thursday evening, so thank you all very much for coming and for staying. I think it's been a really important event. The session that I went to was focused around mental health, and the nature of the discussion was very constructive, but sadly it was based on enormous frustration with the nature and disposition of services that were provided for patients. Having said that, I left with a fairly optimistic point of view, feeling that in many ways the time has come when we can solve many of the problems that were in that room. And I think there are a constellation of things that have come together to help us do that. In many ways, mental health has been a hostage to the history of the way services have developed. In my background as a heart surgeon over many years, we would put patients through some pretty gruesome things, big operations, long time in the intensive care unit. Not surprisingly, a number of them would need some kind of support for that. And yet it was never forthcoming. And why wasn't it forthcoming? Because mental health services and support were provided in some other building, in some other place that was a hassle to get to. And equally, my colleagues who were trying to provide psychiatric and other services were increasingly beginning to recognize that they needed help from those that provided physical services, and yet they weren't getting that support. But things are starting to change. The science has changed. There's a much greater recognition now that there's a very close association between mental health issues and physical health issues. And furthermore, there is a very, very clear and strong economic case that as a country and as a health service that we need to focus on mental health. And then when you add to that, that there are several members who would be quite happy for me to say this, of senior people in NHS England, myself included, who have had very close familial associations with serious mental health problems. We recognize the issues, and we are, in fact, determined to deal with them. So I think we've come to a point where the science, the economics, and the aspirations of patients starting to match. And that is a pretty strong, I think, driver for change. So within the forum that we were in this afternoon, there were a number of issues that have come up, and I, of course, won't be able to cover them all. But the first was that there's an issue about access to mental health services, and I've alluded to that already. But in particular, there's a feeling, as one person put it, that when you are in a very bad mental health state and you ring up and they say it's going to be 6 months before you're seen, is a bit like ringing 999 and they say, oh, we'll send a policeman around in a couple of weeks. And so this is a serious problem, and we do need to go away and think about how we make it much easier and much more timely for people to get help when they need it. The second thing is the so-called, and my apologies to Roger Goss, parity of esteem, which effectively means that we need to put as much time and attention into developing the services for mental health as we do in physical health. And that takes us into areas of education, particularly education for many of the professionals in our services, doctors, nurses, and others, some of whom have not been that good at recognizing the association between mental health problems and standard medical problems. And that then leads us into how we design our services in a way that makes it easier for people to get both physical and mental health help when they need it. The next thing which was really quite striking was that services are very disjointed. And we heard a number of stories from people who felt that their mental health condition had been made much worse by the utter frustration, anger, and anxiety that they felt by being bounced from pillar to post like a pinball in a pinball machine. And they felt that it actually made matters worse. So we have a duty in terms of our humanitarian approach, our clinical approach, and our organizational approach to ensure that the way we design services and help others design services, that it doesn't make people's condition worse. And finally, there were comments about peer support, and it seems clear to me, leaving the room this afternoon, that there's a lot we can do to help bring people together. because as someone put it, we use talking therapies in a clinical way, but there's nothing better than talking to people with similar problems to help you resolve your own. So there is a lot of evidence in the physical world that peer support helps when people with diabetes talk about it or people with rheumatoid arthritis get together. And similarly, there are big opportunities that we can exploit in mental health. And one of the, probably the final area that we touched on was the growing mental health problems of the younger population who are subject to a lot of external stresses, which older members of the audience and might not have experienced, which come through much greater connectivity that is afforded through the social media and others. And we're in the process in NHS England of really completely looking at how we reprovide those services in a more effective way. So I leave you, I think, with an optimistic thought that a number of things have come together that mean that we will be able to report back to you in a year's time that we've made at least some, if not considerable, progress. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Bruce. I'm going to move very swiftly on to the last workshop feedback. So Jane Cummings is our chief nurse, but was talking with a group of children and young people, and actually picking up on Bruce's last point around young people's access to mental health services. I think that was quite a hot topic in your group as well.
Yes, thank you, Olivia, and good evening, everybody. It was an incredibly powerful and brilliant session, actually, that I was privileged to be at this afternoon. And I think a lot of what we've heard already was replicated in the group we're in with children and young people. And I suppose that is inevitable, because looking at all of the other issues that my colleagues have spoken about is also something that is very meaningful for children and young people. As a group and as a room, it was very powerful, it was very positive, it was very vibrant and energetic. And everybody that was in that room felt and contributed significantly, both with ideas about what should and could happen to make things better, but also sharing their personal experiences and the experiences of others that highlighted with significant clarity and quite a lot of difficulty, actually, to hear what was going well and what wasn't going well. And I think, for me, thank you very much for those young people that were able to share those stories, but also something that made it very meaningful in terms of what we are trying to do and what we need to do. So I will try and summarise some of the themes that I heard discussed, and then talk a little bit about some of the things I think we can do, and we may want to come back to that a bit later. So one of the first areas that people talked about was that of transition. So the transition from being cared for as a child or a young person into being an adult. And a significant amount of frustration about how difficult that was for them. So not only is it often, you are often facing a transition at a time when things are quite difficult, so doing exams at school, preparing for university, being a teenager with all the normal things that happen with teenagers, and I've got two teenage nieces at the moment, so I'm living and breathing that with them on a day-to-day basis. The issues around how the transition can happen at different ages, so at some case, it will be in the run-up to being 18. In others, it might be when they're slightly older, in their early 20s. And the big issue, a really significant issue, was about how criteria for care changed. So people could, or young children or young people, would be entitled to and get support in an area when they were seen as a child or a young person. But as soon as they transitioned into adult, that disappeared and that criteria changed, and they therefore couldn't access the same level of service. So we heard about somebody that had had a coordinator, a senior nurse, who was able to coordinate all of the care that he needed to link him with all of the specialties that he might need to come into contact with. He could make one phone call and he was supported to get that care. But once he became an adult or was seen as a young adult, that disappeared. So it was then down to him to make multiple phone calls and be passed, as others have said, from pillar to post before finding the right person to support the ongoing care.
and quite frankly, none of us would want that to happen for ourselves or for our loved ones. And so we need to do something about making that better. A lot about voice and about being heard and about being listened to. One of the most powerful things I heard somebody say was, adults don't know everything. They might think they do, but they don't. And maturity isn't based on age. You know, you can have a young person who is incredibly mature, able to discuss what they need and what they want, and we don't listen enough. And quality of care can be variable across the system. We talked a lot about quality of services, about access to services, about being able to get the care needed at the time it was needed, not having to wait. There was things like the physical access, being able to access services in a wheelchair, etc. All of the things that should be there for everybody whenever they need it. And a big theme about joining things up. A lot of discussion about the link between health and education. So why is it that education aren't aware of some of the health needs of children and young people? Why is it that education won't listen or won't get engaged and won't support? Why is it that in some cases the health service won't discuss issues, won't help and support education to do better? There was also issues about joining up between health services, about making sure that there is that coordination, and importantly, between health and social care. So something that really talks about looking at the person as an individual and wrapping services around them rather than expecting individuals to have to try and find their way through. A big issue about value and respect. We heard stories where people were talking about not being listened to, about being talked over, about health professionals talking to parents or talking to carers when the child and young person was in you know, perfectly capable and willing and wanted to be able to tell their story, to talk about how they felt, to describe what they needed. And this sense that because they were young, it didn't matter, and that the healthcare professionals should and could talk to parents. So a really big issue for me, and one of the things that I committed to do in the room, was that using my influence across the nursing midwifery profession and working with Bruce, he doesn't know this yet, but I'll tell him now, working with Bruce around the medical profession about reinforcing the importance of talking to people as individuals and actually valuing and listening to what they have to say, whatever their age. We talked a lot about diversity and individuality. Barbara talked about the transgenderage issue. We heard a very, very powerful story about a young person and the issues that you face if you're lesbian, gay, transgender. What those issues, having gender dysmorphia and actually being able to get access to services and talk to people who understand, who know what you're talking about, who listen to you, who will actually refer you to those right services. And lastly, it was about don't forget the outcomes. There's all very well talking about input measures, about making sure we do that, but making sure that actually what we're doing and the care and support we put in place is something that is meaningful to the individual child or young person, and that it delivers the best outcomes for them, the best experience, the best care, and the best safe care. So in terms of what we talked about, I think, as I've mentioned already, the professional agenda, making sure that healthcare professionals do actually treat people as individuals, do listen to what children and young people say and talk to them, not about them. And also engaging and living what we say are our values, which is effectively, if we say we want to do co-production, if we say we want to listen, then truly do that. Hear what people say, ask them to help us design what we want to do, design our services, co-produce, and actually, you know, as somebody said to us, you know, we're vesting a lot of interest in you, we're vesting a lot of trust in you, so show us and demonstrate that you actually mean what you say and that you'll do something. Thank you.
Jane, thank you very much, and thank you all very much. It's working. Can you hear me?
Oh, that's better. You must be able to hear me now. So my name, thank you all very much. My name is Simon Burrell. I'm one of the team of four organisations that's helping NHS England to design NHS Citizen. I'm really not going to speak very long. I've been one of the two people facilitating the whole day. We've had 250 citizens sitting down and taking their own time, and we've asked these four to come up at very, very last minute as citizens to give their personal view of what they heard. But specifically, I'm going to ask them two things. One, is what you've just heard from the directors, does it reflect what you heard in the room for the whole day? And secondly, is what they say they're going to do enough? Now, Emma has to go at 15:15, so I'll apologise on your behalf to have to leave the stage. We're very sorry to have kept you, but we thank you so much, and I'm going to hand over to you.
Thank you for your kind words, Barbara. Yes, it is reflective of what was said in the room. It was nicely distilled, and it spoke to a lot of the issues. I did speak earlier on, and I said the issues are far, far, far greater than a day's discussion, and I think it's a beginning. It's a good beginning, and it's great that the board have actually been there and listened, and it would be great if the board did some meaningful, fantastic interventions for all four areas and other areas, to be honest. There were raised some very, very clear and prescient issues around waiting, around the inequalities of waiting for trans people, waiting for services, and waiting for appropriate services, because rather than, as somebody, a friend of mine calls it, a sausage factory, where you plug somebody in at one end and you get a different gender out the other end, a holistic process that works for people. There are some key areas around the 7 gender identity clinics around the country at the moment where there's the disparity, and hopefully the new protocol will give some resolution to that. This means nothing to you, I suspect. But what I would like to see is hopefully that the board go away and listen and maybe look at some of the current issues that we discussed around particular waiting lists in certain areas, and lubricate the wheels, I think is the right way of doing it, in a diplomatic, strategic, pressurized way. But for me, this is a fantastic start. And I'm genuinely not trying to blow smoke, but it's a fantastic start that these people have actually taken the time to come when it would have been very, very easy for them as board members to sit in the boardroom, sit in the various places where the DOH and NHS England reside across the country. They take the time to listen to us, and I do appreciate that. But I hope it elicits actions, genuine actions, for a very, very marginalised group of people.
Emma, in a perfect illustration that the NHS doesn't work around people's lives, Emma does have to go to catch a train. So you'll now leave the stage. And Fiona, I'm going to hand over to you. Did you what you heard reflect what you heard in the room, and is the action enough?
Vice Darlington, and she's been here as a citizen today participating in those conversations. So Fiona, perhaps you could just say who you are very briefly before you provide your feedback.
Okay, hello, my name is Fiona Carey. I'm a patient representative from the East of England. I think that what Tim spoke about, Tim was in our group this afternoon, was a pretty fair reflection of the discussions that happened during the day, necessarily distilled from a discussion that had already been distilled, because these discussions are necessarily a bit rushed, you're trying to cram a lot in, and it, you know, by the time everybody's got to know each other's first name, you know, there's not a lot of the day left. It's, you know, it's very difficult to do this and to do it well. Tim, I think, restated the issues. I think all of the board members have actually, they've clearly listened, they've clearly taken notes, and, you know, they're reasonably bright people, I think, and they've recounted the issues. I think I think what I'd like to hear next is clearer statements about what he's been committed to. Because, and, you know, we know how to do this. It's about smart objectives that are, you know, measurable. And, you know, we're talking about a time limit, a delivery date. We're talking about being fairly clear and specific about what it is we're going to deliver. So I think this is a very open door. I think we've had a great day here. I shouldn't go on. It's been a tremendous day, and it's been very encouraging, really. It's great that the board are here. But as we said earlier, this is just the start. It's going to be difficult to do this. We are going to call you to account because you invited us to, and we really, you know, intend to make that serious. So we will be back, and we'll have questions to ask.
Fiona, thank you. I'm not going to try and follow that. Emerson, just say who you are and where you're from before you reflect.
Emerson Walgrove from Bradford Health Watch and Chair of Bevan Health Patient Participation Group. Yes, Bruce, Sir Bruce did reflect what was discussed in our discussion for mental health, but I didn't hear any solid commitments on that, like, are we going to have a commitment that all GPs are educated, trained on mental health and how to treat people, or about the commitment about getting educated and getting it into schools, because it's about the prevention, not the reactive. So about educating in primary schools and getting our teaching staff to be educated about mental health. I didn't hear a commitment about service users are going to be respected across the NHS. There isn't a clear definition in the NHS constitution about mental health service users across the board being respected, but there is a clear about all NHS users. There wasn't a commitment for more funding into what is what I regard, and I would think most people regard, a Cinderella service across the country for mental health. And there wasn't any I didn't hear a commitment about putting more emphasis, although a fair emphasis, because what we have is a disparity of a fairness across in mental health, about your five-year plan, about including in that five-year plan clear information about mental health.
Thank you, and that clearly resonates with the room. We're only hearing from four of the groups because for failures largely on my part, I didn't manage to get the right citizen up here. So Ian, you're getting a slightly easy ride, but we will make sure that that group gets a chance to come back to you, and we will make sure that goes up on the NHS Citizen blog. But I'm going to hand over to Kat, and then Olivia will take over to finish.
One second quickly before I start though. So my background, I've used mental health services for about the last decade or so.
Sorry to stop you. Just say who you are, just quickly. Yeah. Where you're from. That's what you're doing.
I'm Kat, I'm from Hertfordshire. I wear many hats. One of those is as a mental health service user. Having used services for about a decade, I've kind of seen a lot. I also have worked for the NHS, and I now work with the NHS in my organisation. And so on that point... So for me, one of the things that I'm really happy about is, one, Jane really did get what was happening in the room. She really sat down and listened to young people, you know, even when they were saying pretty distressing things, pretty bad experiences. But also, Jane, I liked that you saw something that was really representative of young people, which is the side that we don't see. A lot of the time, I think young people get tarred with the same brush as being apathetic. They're disillusioned. They actually want someone to reach out to them. And today they were actually given a space where they could talk about the issues that are important to them. And they actually had the ear of people like Jane and Simon Stevens. So one young person in particular that I spoke to had no idea it was Simon Stevens he was chewing the ear of. So I think what's really great is that this has been an experience for everyone. I think everyone's learned something, and I really hope that actually we do get commitments for children and young people who too often aren't seen as politically important enough because they don't have a vote or are told that they don't have enough experience to understand what they're talking about. Actually, if you have a condition, you're an expert by experience. So thank you, Jane. Thank you, everyone, for coming.
Kat, thank you. So there's a bit of a pushback there that actually you've really heard, you've really understood, but we're perhaps a little bit wishy-washy in our commitments. Is that a fair?
Yep, I'd say yes.
Okay, so just to put board members on the spot, I wonder if anybody wants to kind of come back and say, okay, we're going to go away and think about that. And Tim?
Well, I just want to say... how impressed, I mean, you've thanked us for listening, but to be honest, I'm really quite moved by the extraordinary way in which everyone's just been so honest and open, and, you know, we're all in these jobs because we care about making this health service, our health service, work better, and we've all, everyone individually in this group and everyone in the room has had good and bad experiences of it, and I just feel really strongly that we have a collective opportunity to do something really different, and there are all sorts of reasons we know about why we have to do that quite urgently. So I guess I mean we will come back. Well, I can't speak for everybody, but I'm pretty confident we will come back with real commitments that are really measurable, that absolutely stack up against what we said we're going to do. And if we're being wishy-washy, it's not for lack of commitment. It's just because we need to spend some time really thinking through how we can make the best efforts.
Hey, Ian.
Could I just add to Tim's kind of comments? Because I suppose in the 20 years I've been working in health, I've seen lots of different commitments given around tackling lots of the issues that we're raising. And people that have made those commitments have fervently wanted to make the NHS even better. And if we haven't succeeded, it's because some of this is really difficult to do. And we don't know actually how to crack some of these issues. And actually, if we were to invent here, in this conversation, a set of new policies, strategies, actions that said, this is what we're going to do, we would get it wrong, because that's one of the problems, is how do we actually design some of the answers with communities and with patients? Because I think it's only by trying to understand better why things that we've said would happen in the past haven't happened, that we're actually likely to make some progress. And the other point I just wanted to pick up on is, of course, there's loads of challenges and problems that we need to try and address. But equally, if you look at any international studies, and I'm particularly thinking of the work of the Commonwealth Fund, by international standards, the NHS scores better than healthcare in the United States and in many other countries, and I think we should be very proud of it.
Why don't you stop the cuts and privatisation?
Okay, Bruce. Can we try and keep the conversation going? There is.
Can I please just come back to the challenge about commitments on mental health? It would be utterly dishonest of me to walk out of one room having heard a bunch of things which people are thinking about and then to stand up here a few minutes later and commit to increasing funding, forcing GPs to behave in a different way, so on and so forth. I would have been absolutely open to the criticism of meaningless promises. The job of this board is to listen today, to go back and reflect in a proper way, and then to determine exactly what we're going to do and how we're going to do it. That is how we'll get our credibility, not by making meaningless immediate promises.
So we've been trying to have some respectful conversations, and we're going to come to questions. questions from the floor at the end of the session. So if we could... Because from a facilitation point of view, we simply didn't have somebody that... No, it's not, because you asked the difficult questions. Okay, you can't actually be heard by the whole room. You can't be heard by the webcast. We're going to wrap up this piece now, and I'm going to hand it back to Malcolm for the formal part of the AGM. And I think both Malcolm and Simon will give us some reflections as well on what they've heard today. Can I say a big thank you to our board members who are in the audience as well, who participated and really listened today. And a very big thank you to Emma, who's left, Fiona, Emerson and Kat, for giving us really honest and insightful feedback. And to everybody who participated throughout the whole day today. Thank you.
Phone is working? I am live, but only in that respect. Anyway, I turn now to the formal part of the business, but before I do, I just would like to repeat our grateful thanks. Is that better? Good, thank you. I just want to repeat our grateful thanks to Emma, Fiona, Emerson and Kat. It's not easy, actually, to come up on the stage and to, I think, present such profound comments with honesty and with integrity, and those are the senses in which those views will be taken back by my board. We will, later this evening, have an opportunity for Q&A, but I want to open the formal part of the business by saying, first of all, that this is the occasion in which the board presents its annual report and accounts. That is a document of which there is a summary in the foyer, and I hope people have been able to pick it up. I'm not going to take you in detail through it, because that would empty the auditorium rather rapidly. But it's appropriate, I think, that I draw attention to some of the key messages that are there. First, to understand what NHS England is. NHS England started life as the NHS Commissioning Board, and that captures the primacy of the role that the organisation has. The government's health reforms in 2012 were headed liberating the NHS. And the... Thank you very much. No. I'd be very grateful for an opportunity just to continue. The point that I'm making is that the board that will be shortly assembled on this stage has a central role. Our responsibility is to share with the Secretary of State for Health the promotion of a comprehensive health service for England, free at the point of need and available to all the citizens. Please, I'm very grateful to you for comments, but please, will you just allow me to say what I would like to say? Thank you very much. Now, the report outlines to you a number of the things that we've managed to do in our first year. Our job is to invest the budget of the NHS to produce continuous improvement in the health of England. What we don't do is run hospitals. We don't run GP surgeries. Those are parts of a service, that's a system that is joined up, often imperfectly, but nonetheless an ecosystem that serves the entire country of England. But it's an ecosystem that's under enormous stress. Let me first of all point to what some of those stresses are. We're now treating more patients in hospital than ever. Do you know we are now treating 1.5 million people who are being referred for treatment every month? And since 2010, our hospitals are now performing 2,000 more operations every day. Our GPs are under increasing pressure. 1 million people see their GP every working day. This is an extraordinary complex system. Between 1999 and 2008, the average number of consultations for GPs rose from 4.1 to 5.5 per patient per year. It's a consequence of a number of socio-demographic trends, including an aging population, which is excellent news, but which makes new and quite complex demands on a health service. We've seen, in parallel with that, a very significant increase in attendances of patients at A&E. The number of attendances has risen by 2 million a year over the last 10 years to where it is now. It's about 16 million attendances at A&E every year. Emergency admissions, as a consequence often of attendance at A&E or as a consequence of blue light arrival at hospital, have gone up year on year, and over the past 10 years are up by 31%. This is, by the way, partly driven by an increase in population, but much more by an increase in expectations and by an increase in demand and changes in the burden of disease away from those sorts of diseases and conditions which brought about early death to those with which people will live over time. And an aging population inevitably creates a different set of requirements and a different set of demands for the staff of the NHS. At this point, what I would just like to say is make a comment about those who serve us. The budget that we command employs ultimately some 1.3 million people. It's an extraordinary workforce. And alongside it, by the way, is an extraordinary voluntary workforce, some of which we heard about today. Those people who provide care in the communities, those people who support families, those people whose work is very frequently not remunerated. It's given out of love. It's given out of duty, it's given out of support, and in many cases, it's given out of sheer community spiritedness, much of which I heard this afternoon. And one of the sessions that I attended, I thought, was extremely moving in understanding how to better connect care systems and provide that support. The situation, however, is very difficult. Those increased demands on the provision of healthcare in England come at a time when the pattern of demand has got out of alignment with the pattern of funding. Since 1948, and I think the conditions are very clear to everybody in this room, since 1948, investment in the NHS has gone up by about 3 to 4% per annum above inflation. So additional spending power of 3 to 4% per annum above inflation since... I've got a mic. Are you able to hear me at the back?
When you raise your voice, we are.
When I raise my voice, you can hear it. Okay. I don't want to holler, but let me just explain. 3 to 4% increase in demand. Since 1948, 3 to 4% increase in funding for the NHS over inflation. Since 2010, am I shouting loud enough? Thank you. Since 2010, by the way, the pattern has changed. As a consequence of the global financial crisis in 2008, the funding for the NHS has been held at little over inflation. Now, in one level, you may say that is quite shocking, given that increase in demand. But if you look at the increase and decrease in investment in public services, you find that the NHS has been protected, where a number of other public services, including local government, has not been protected. Can I just give the basic? Local government has experienced significant reductions in expenditure, and that does not have a beneficial impact in the relationship between the NHS and social care, which is something that we need to turn our attention to. Now, I'm not saying that the NHS is in dire crisis, and one of the reasons it's not is the extraordinary workforce to whom publicly this evening I wish to express our enormous gratitude, and we all of us, thank you. But we also know that the coming years are going to be difficult, and we will, in a few weeks' time, be publishing from NHS England a five-year forward view of what we think are the main principles around which the NHS can be regrouped and retransformed for the future to provide the high quality of service that we've heard our users require. So let me conclude by doing two things. One is to thank you for joining us tonight. Another one is to thank everyone on the staff of NHS England for what they've done over the past year. It's been an extraordinary performance, not least to set up a brand new organisation from scratch to bring into play an entire new model of funding the NHS and to work with such outstanding people. I would particularly like to express my thanks to those who allowed us to produce our annual report on time and to budget. I will in a moment invite Paul Bauman, our financial officer, to talk to those figures. But at first, I would very much like you please to welcome our chief executive, Simon Stevens, who will talk about today and the future. There, Simon Stevens.
What can I do? Get a third hand?
Could we get one or other of these mics up?
That's weird.
Yep. No.
Shall I just try shouting? Okay. I'm going to keep it short and hopefully sweet because I get the impression that the woman here is keen to get stuck into the questions and answers, and I'm keen to do that as well. And I know there's a group over here who also would like us to have a good old debate about the future of the NHS, which suits me just fine. So I'm just going to say three things. First of all, those who say that the NHS cannot make it and that it's going down the pan and are running it down deliberately, they are wrong. That is my state of assessment of the National Health Service. And the reason they are wrong is actually because the quality of care, despite the incredible difficult circumstances that we are having to face, is actually incredibly high. That's what patients, that's what the public say in this country, and that's why they want to defend and secure and build on the National Health Service rather than can it. And the facts are these. Yes, this is the longest period of budget austerity that we have ever seen for the National Health Service. We are in year five of effectively a flat budget. And yes, that means that there are incredible pressures on our staff, on GPs, on nurses, on frontline employees, many of whom have had to have huge sacrifice in terms of the pay constraint that they have had. But the fact is, if you cast your mind back to what the NHS was like 10 years ago, you were waiting 18 months for a hip operation or a cataract. Now, most people are waiting less than 18 weeks. The average wait for an operation is 10 weeks. It is because the funding increased. It is because the funding increased. You're quite right. If I had my card, I'd be putting the yes up back to you right now. And that proves the lie that the NHS cannot use investment to improve. It can, it has, and in future it will. If you think back to the likelihood, if you had a heart attack in the 1970s, of surviving, the fact is that only one in four people would have died. 19 out of 20 people now survive. If you think back to the 1970s, what were your chances of surviving cancer? One in four people made it through the decade. One in two make it through now. So the fact is that the NHS is a model that works, quality of care is very high, and that's what the people that we serve uniformly report. That's the first of my three points. The second, however, is that all the conversations that we've been having this afternoon, all the discussions that we have right around the country, demonstrate that what's great about the NHS cannot excuse what needs to change about the NHS. And if you had been in the conversation that I was in this afternoon with people who have had often some pretty dysfunctional experiences of our mental health services, if you had been in the conversation that I and some of my colleagues were with a group of people with learning disabilities a couple of weeks ago, talking about how they were effectively controlled and manipulated by like it or lump it health services, then you would recognise we need to improve. If you spent time, as I did in my first week in taking up this job, with families and relatives in mid-Staffordshire who had been on the receiving end of poor quality care, let's call a spade, you would know that we need to improve. Sorry? Well, it's actually the truth, and it's not just a soundbite, it's the result of two public inquiries and Sir Robert Francis's report. So let the facts speak for the facts. Now then. As to, yeah, the quite right. So, so,
if you want to do questions and answers, we will listen
really
gladly.
Okay, thank you for that corrective. So the third and final point I want to make, in addition to the fact that quality of care is high despite all the difficulties and the fact that that doesn't mean we should be complacent about the status quo, is that as we look out over the next 5 years and beyond, we are going to have to do things quite differently to overcome a number of the historic barriers, the gaps, the false divisions that exist across the National Health Service. And I think there are at least six of them. The first is the artificial divide between general health services, physical health services, and mental health services. And so the question that came up in the panel just now about, so what are you actually going to do about it? Well, here's one thing we actually are going to do about it as NHS England, which is that for the first time ever, 25 years after waiting times standards were introduced for hip surgery or elective surgery in physical health services, we will introduce mental health standards, access standards from next year. It will just be a start and we will make progress, but that's part of getting equality of esteem. There is an artificial divide in this country, which is not just since 1948, but which goes back way before that, in fact, between primary care and hospital care, between general practice, community services, and hospital services. The GPs are, in many cases, worked off their feet. Patients are often passed pillar to post between GPs, community services, A&E departments, other parts of the system. That needs to change. When I was three Friday nights ago at the out-of-hours service, the urgent care service, serving people in Barking and Redbridge and Waltham Forest, listening to some of those conversations, calls with patients, it was pretty obvious that people were having to try and navigate through completely confusing Heath Robinson-style systems that are in our gift to change. So that's the second division, primary, secondary care. We've got to overcome that. The third is this historic split that we've had in this country between health and social care. There are no easy answers as to how we do this, particularly when it comes to funding, but the reality is that seen from the point of view of many of the heaviest users of our services, this now is not just a distinction without a difference, it's a distinction which is actually undermining the very ability of people to live the lives that they want to lead. The fourth division that we've got to overcome is the difference between a focus purely on prevention and the treatment consequences of this. And I was speaking yesterday at the conference of Public Health England and talking about how if we are just going to sleepwalk into the future of a nation where, for example, we ignore well-being, but also we have this obesity epidemic, which is on the rise, one in five of our children now obese at secondary school, we are on a track to lost lives, to preventable illness, and to billions of pounds in extra healthcare costs that actually weaken rather than strengthen what it is we're all trying to do. So if we're going to get serious about that, that's not just things the NHS can do. That's going to take a wider set of changes across society. In my opinion, it's going to require more power for local councils. It's going to require getting a little heavy with some of the junk food that is shoved down people's throats. It's going to have to call some frank conversations about the way in which we allow people to make decisions about financial incentives, fiscal incentives, the way different parts of the food chain are taxed and so on. So these are all difficult national conversations we're going to have, and I think the NHS has to have a voice in those conversations rather than just assume that's somebody else's business. I think we've got a fifth set of changes we've got to think about, which is that the NHS, as well as being a care provider, is also a massive employer. We know that for the 1.3 million people that we're employing, actually, whereas the NHS could set a good example in terms of what a healthy workplace and a healthy workforce is, sometimes we're often the worst offenders when it comes to that. This doesn't just show up in terms of the provision of hospital food or various other things. It's the fact that whereas, for example, three quarters of hospitals say that they provide quitting smoking support for staff,
Only a third do the same in terms of exercise or weight management or other things to help our own staff in supported environments. So we've got to change that. And as part of that, frankly, we've got to be better as the NHS, soup to nuts, at representing the communities that we serve. We have too many leadership cadres in the NHS, too many boards of hospitals and providers that are not representative of the communities they serve. We have seen particularly the exclusion of black and minority ethnic communities from the leadership of many of our hospitals, and that is bad for patients, it is bad for the NHS, it is ultimately the root of where we fail to listen. So we've got to make that change as well. And then the last of the changes that I think we've got to make as we look out is we've got to stop seeing the NHS as a sealed factory in some way and recognise that it is embedded in the communities that it serves. And yes, that means supporting, for example, the 5.5 million carers in this country. It means recognising we need a completely changed relationship with volunteers. And that is about a profound shift in power that I think we are just at the very early stages of thinking through what that would actually mean. It's going to require some difficult, honest, sometimes confrontational, but hopefully nevertheless authentic conversations, of which tonight is just the beginning. So I'm proud to be here tonight because in this country we have a health service of the people, by the people and for the people, and that's certainly what I am committed to sustaining. Thanks very much.
Well, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. The good news is I am a singer, so I can probably project my voice reasonably well. The bad news is I'm a singer with a very damn bad cold, so I probably can't project it very clearly. I'm going to try and keep my comments very brief, because I'm conscious I stand between a visionary statement and a debate on its consequences. I do need very briefly to take you through the financial performance of the NHS commissioning system for last year as part of the formalities of the AGM. And that's what I'll do in the next couple of minutes. A year, of course, is a very long time in the NHS. This time last year at the AGM, I reported on the financial performance of a £60 million organisation with all of 45 permanent staff and virtually no operational responsibilities whatsoever. This year, I've got a couple of minutes and a couple of charts to describe the financial affairs of a complex £96 billion group of 212 interdependent organisations employing the best part of 28,000 people, created overnight on the 1st of April 2013, probably as the biggest start-up in British history. In my presentation last year, I spoke about the Herculean task ahead of us at that time of making sure that all of those 212 organisations maintained financial control during their first year of operation and completed high-quality accounts in line with what looked to many to be a virtually impossible and challenging timetable. So before turning to the numbers themselves, I do want to put on record my deep appreciation of the really Herculean efforts and sheer professional skill which went in on the part of the CCG teams, the commissioning support unit teams, and indeed the NHS England teams into producing that set of accounts, 212 sets of high-quality accounts delivered on time, in full, without significant last-minute adjustments, and slightly to my surprise, with universally positive, true and fair views from a set of auditors who are professionally sceptical by nature and who certainly enjoyed that particular role last year. So that's just before I come to the numbers. All of this activity culminated... Is my clicker going to work? Oh, you've gone too now, thank you. All of that activity culminated in this report and accounts, which Malcolm has mentioned. It was laid before Parliament on the 22nd of July. It's available from the publication section of our website, and I'm reliably informed that probably from all good booksellers as well. At 191 pages long, it's probably not the most pithy tome you'll come across, but it does make a good read, and if it doesn't make a good read, I've also discovered it's very good for furniture that doesn't quite sit evenly on the ground, so do try that out if you prefer. I'm also pleased to report, as it says on the right-hand side, that not only was it done on time, but it fulfilled all six of the highly technical financial limits and requirements put on us by Department of Health and Treasury, which you can see up there, gets accountants very excited. For the rest of us, I suspect that probably the basic numbers will do. This is then the 2013 performance. As you can see from this chart, expenditure in 13-14 was 279 million lower than planned, which, like everything in the NHS, sounds like a horrendously big number, but is actually close to a point landing on a postage stamp at 0.3% of the planned spend of 94.7 billion. Given the newness of the organisations concerned and the inherent risk associated with the transition from the old to the new, I think most would agree that's a better outcome than many commentators had expected. One of the key tasks for the finance teams around the country during 13-14 was to close down the balance sheets of PCTs and SHAs, a massive and complex undertaking for which I'd also like to express my thanks to the finance teams concerned. The net result of this process was the so-called legacy you can see at the bottom of that sheet, a positive adjustment to the closing balance sheets of 133 million, equivalent to about 2.5% of the value estimated at the end of 12-13, which effectively comes through in our accounts as a one-off reduction in expenditure. Now, to complete the picture, we've generally reported the performance of the NHS in terms of bottom-line surpluses, the difference between the resources made available in our mandate and the expenditure which I've just been reporting on. So when I magically bring in the mandate funding, which fortunately the Treasury does every year, you can see that our surplus, excluding those once-off legacy impacts, amounts to 813 million, or just under 1% of our resources. It's also important, though, just to remember that this is a cumulative surplus. It's not an in-year number. It therefore includes all of the underspends brought forward from previous years, which are given back to us in the mandate funding we receive from the Treasury. So actually, this 813 million surplus I've talked about at the end of 13-14 is in fact a reduction compared to the surplus we brought forward at the start of the year. In other words, we've actually spent 371 million of the money brought forward from previous years in addition to the money given to us in our recurrent allocation for last year. On the positive side, that's less than the facility we agreed with the Treasury and the Department of Health, but for fairly obvious reasons, we can't continue to live off a declining trend of prior year surpluses forever. So in summary, our financial performance was better than planned. We fulfilled all Treasury and Department of Health requirements, but the tightening of the NHS finances is already becoming very apparent, both in our numbers, as you can see, and in the well-publicised challenges in the provider sector. And it's for that reason that I think we have to think of our financial journey as more of a marathon than a kind of one-year sprint. This happens to be the guy that put together the accounts I've just presented to you. As you can see, I only recruit people who are slightly fitter than I am. He is an Ironman and marathon runner, but my point here is we are all in this for a financial marathon over the next few years. It's for that reason that it took us significantly longer than in certainly any year that I've been involved in the NHS, which is a few but not many, to get our planning sorted out this year. It was much tougher than it normally is. It's for that reason that on a month-by-month basis, we're looking really carefully at any sign of financial distress coming through in the system. And it's for that reason that the five-year view process that we've been talking about today and which came very strongly to the fore in Malcolm and Simon's speeches is not just an important thing to do for the future of the health service, but it's becoming increasingly urgent. And with that, I'll pass to the next session. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Paul, and can I, on behalf of the whole board, express our gratitude. There's so much goes on in the back rooms of organisations like this of such complexity and such Herculean effort. It's often not recognised and acknowledged in public. To get those annual reports and the accounts into Parliament by the 22nd of July is unprecedented, and I do owe you, Paul, and your team an enormous debt of gratitude. Thank you so much for all that you've done. So now we move to the question and answers. What I'm going to do is to invite all the members of the board of NHS England to join me, please, on the stage. I'll then introduce them and we'll proceed to the question and answer session. Ladies and gentlemen, what a fine array. What I'm going to be able to do, I'll introduce all members of the board in a moment, and then I'll outline how I would like to run the question and answer session. But please, take this as testament to the transparency of the operation of the board. I believe strongly that a board which has the privilege that we have of serving the population in the way that we do should be visible and accountable to you in public. So I'm going to introduce all of the members of the board. Let me first of all explain that there are two types of members of the board, by which I don't mean competent and incompetent. I mean there are two types of members of the board. First, there are those who are our full-time employees, the so-called executive members of the board, led by Simon Stevens as the chief executive. And then there are the non-executive members, including myself, people who are not full-time employees of NHS England, but are like on the board of a hospital trust or a major charity or a company, people from outside who maintain a strict governance relationship with the executive team, hold them to account, but also, in our case, work very closely as a team. So let me start on my far right with Noel Gordon, who's a recent appointment to the board, a strategist with a lifetime of experience with Accenture, the consultants. Lord Victor Adebowale of the House of Lords, but also the chief executive of Turning Point, the charity. Sir John Byrne, who's a clinical geneticist, an outstanding geneticist in the northeast of England, and also, I would say, a clinical entrepreneur, as well as being a major scientist and a professor there. So those three are non-executive members. I turn to an executive member of the board, Karen Wheeler, whose job title I love. She's the National Director for Transformation and Operations. Those two merge together rather neatly. A non-executive director is Margaret Casely Hayford. Margaret has recently retired from an exceptional job, which is of great value to us as being the secretary to John Lewis Partnership. And understanding how a great organization like that works, how a great organization like that works with its customers and with its staff has been invaluable to us. Kieran Devane is currently the chief executive of Macmillan Cancer Care, Cancer Support, but shortly will take up a new appointment as the Director General of the British Council. David Roberts, a recent appointment, has been until recently the deputy chairman of the Lloyds Banking Group and is now to be the new chairman of Nationwide, somebody who can help us with those extraordinarily complex figures that Paul Bauman has just been referring to. And Dame Moira Gibb, former chief executive of the London Borough of Camden, but with a lifetime career in social services and understanding the relationship between social and health care. So I should have said that those four are non-executive directors. Ian Dodge, who's already been introduced, is a new director for commissioning strategy. Jane Cummings, our chief nurse for England, and Barbara Haken, whose role is commissioning operations. Executive directors, along with Sir Bruce Keogh, the nation's favourite doctor. I'm sorry, the medical director of NHS England. And Tim Kelsey, Director for Patients and Information. I think Simon Stevens needs no further introduction, nor does Paul Bauman, but of great importance to me is my Deputy Chairman, Ed Smith, a lifetime of working in strategy and an extraordinary assistance to us all in devising the future course of NHS England. So that's the team. Let me just suggest some rules of engagement, because I think there's a lot of active interest, if I may say, in the room around the work of NHS England. Can I suggest that rule one is respect? Anybody who listened to those voices from the Citizens' Assembly will know what I mean. If you speak with respect, people will listen and understand. This isn't an occasion for barracking. Secondly, when I invite people, could you please tell me your name? And if you want to, if there's relevant background, if, for example, you've experienced NHS care in some particular capacity. Thirdly, what I would suggest is questions rather than speeches, because if you want answers, you won't get them to speeches, but you'll get them to questions. And then finally, what I would like to do is to take, say, three questions at once from different parts of the hall, and then I will invite who I think are appropriate members of the board to respond to those questions. So, I'm seeing yes, which I hope suggests that is agreement with my modus operandi. And we have some roving microphones, and we're about to kick off. So let me then start. Sorry, I just need to make a note of the questions as they come in. Right, now, there's a gentleman here, Laura, there's a gentleman there with his papers in the air. Shall we start with him, and then I'll come over in this direction.
Okay, Dave Shepherd, former member of a community health council, and until I resigned, an NHS forum member. Two questions, short ones. Can Dr. John Lister of Health Emergency, who says that the NHS exists in England and it's worth preserving,
somebody said the NHS is what?
Dr. John Lister says the NHS exists in England and we should join any committee to help it preserve its life. Or Professor Alison Pollock, who's written a book saying that the NHS does not exist any longer in England, but it does in Scotland and Wales. Can they both be right, or what is the opinion of your finance?
Okay, that's a really good question to kick us off with.
Second question.
Oh, there's a second one, right?
I am actually also an unpaid creditor of the NHS in respect of the compulsory privatised part of my blood contributions, which I said should not go to private patients. They are given free to private hospitals and patients. When may I expect the refund of the value of a half a pint, not the 19 and a half pint?
Right.
And the 32 years in.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
I don't mind setting off the expenditure of the NHS on the biscuits and coffee and tea and orange juice that I consumed as a contributor to the NHS Blood Bank.
Well, I'm grateful to that. So that's a set-off, which we appreciate. Let me take question two. Gentleman right here in the front row, if I may. Sorry, Laura. Where is the other microphone? Is the one over there? Oh, there's one there. OK, we'll take one from over there. Sir.
Hello. Is that working? Yeah.
That's on.
Hello, my name is Maurice Bernard. Maurice Bernard. I'm a retired consultant psychiatrist and also a member of the NHS Consultants Association. It was mentioned from the stage that you want to listen to the public, and this document says the public should be empowered. But the public don't want NHS services to be privatised. One of the arguments for Scotland to become an independent country, which Alex Salmond has said, is to avoid the privatisation which has occurred in England. They don't want it in Scotland.
Sorry, is there a question?
Yes. The question is, what is going to be done about the conflict of interest between the private sector making a profit and providing a quality service?
Okay, thank you very much. John, right beside you there, the gentleman holding up a yes or no sign. Yeah, well, sorry, Hi. We've got a long way to go this evening.
This
please relax, time
Mark
will come.
Boothroyd.
I'm sorry, start again.
My name's Mark Boothroyd, I'm a staff nurse in the NHS. I'm part of a coalition called Docs Not Cops, and we're really concerned about the impact of the Immigration Act and its effect on access to NHS services. Basically, we think it's going to be used as it's going to deprive migrants and other marginalised groups of access to the NHS, and it will be the first step in introducing charges into the NHS. How are you, as the Board of NHS England, going to make sure that, one, that no one who needs NHS treatment is deprived of access to it, and how are you going to stop NHS staff being complicit in depriving access to people, which is going to be the end result of any kind of charging? We're getting reports already that people are being turned away from GP services, that people are already being, you know, possibly charged wrongly for services, and the Immigration Act and the charging is just going to make that worse.
Okay, thank you for that question. What I'm going to do, having taken those three questions, I'm going to invite Simon. I think, Simon, thank you very much. You may be able to run one or two of those together because they speak to a particular agenda.
Yeah, so on the first one, on David's question, does the NHS still exist? Well, yes, it does still exist in England, and the 1.3 million people who work in it would be surprised to hear that they worked for an organisation which does not now exist. So I think that is pretty self-evident. Of course the NHS exists. Should it continue to exist? In all of our views, most certainly. And we've obviously, no doubt, through further conversation tonight, we'll discuss in what ways you think it should and what ways you think it shouldn't. And that comes on to the question at the front here around how do you deal with the situation where you've got non-NHS providers and how do you deal with the quality concerns? And the answer there, I think, is that everybody providing services for NHS patients has to now go through the Care Quality Commission independent quality inspectorate so that there is complete transparency as to how well they're doing, and where they're no good, they get kicked out. And then in terms of the question on migrants, one of the people who was here and I was speaking to earlier this afternoon, in fact, was a guy from Bolton, who's an Afghanistani refugee, and we were talking about the experience that refugees have around the country, and I think you put your finger on a very important point. Not just about refugees, but actually about what, in a patronising way, the NHS has traditionally called hard-to-reach communities. There are no hard-to-reach communities, there are just hard-to-reach services. So I think we've actually got to turn the conversation around and get much more engaged. And I think Bruce was nodding vehemently when you were making your point there, so maybe he wants to add to that. Or maybe he doesn't.
I'm worried about David's blood. I hope that we can come back to David's blood. But can I invite any other member of the board if they have any response they'd like to add to Simon's? No, in which case, let's romp on. Let's take another three. And I know there's a gender complaint from over here. So let me please... let's take it in turn. You, sir, are a man, not you. Please, madam in the front.
My name's Rahana Azam.
Sahana.
Rahana.
Rahana.
Just a really quick question, really. The public don't want the NHS sold off, so can the board give us some assurance that they stop selling our NHS off, please? Thank you.
Okay. Not you, sir, because you're right next to her. I'm going to jump around there, and there's a lady there with her hand up. Yes, that's you, please.
Hi, I'm Judith, and I'm just an ordinary person. I am American, although I've lived here half my life, and I just wonder, you know, we understand, you know, that there's a trade deal on the table that will Americanize our services here. And, you know, as somebody who has experienced for quite a long time the American, you know, health system, you don't want it here, believe me. and the second...
Please, let Judith speak.
The second part of that this is the question.
Ah.
Is there some way that we can avoid, you know, the consequences of a health service split up and run purely for profit that we have in America? If you just look at it, I mean, for one thing, it doesn't work. It has tier after tier of people being, of organizations being ripped off. You know, the insurance companies, everything, the people who have to have the insurance.
So the question is, yeah. Is there a way we can avoid that? Okay. Thank you very much.
Just please avoid it.
No, I'm very grateful for that. I'm going to come into the central part of the room. John, right there, the lady in the row there. Please, yes.
Hello. I'm also a...
Sorry, your name?
My name is Pearl.
Mm-hmm.
I'm also an American who is now a British citizen for many, many years, and I also experience both sides of healthcare. And so I am very, very, very concerned about CETA, ISDS, and TTIP, and how the NHS is not being excluded, and so can NHS England have any influence upon our government to exempt our NHS from the transatlantic free trade agreements?
Okay.
That's a question.
You know, there's...
That is a question, and then I have a second question, which is, it seems to me, an elephant in the room of all of these discussions, that there seems to be a complete disconnect between the benefit system and the NHS. And can NHS England find a way to influence the DWP to stop punishing and killing people with their work capability assessment and return responsibility for assessing people of ill health for benefits back to NHS medical personnel? Thank you. That's two questions.
Okay, no, thank you very much. And can I just... I think there are two aspects to those three, four questions. The first one is about selling off the NHS. I'm just going to ask the board, is there anybody on the board who's in favour of selling off the NHS?
You're doing it already.
Can we just be clear about the... We have an NHS which is largely funded from the public purse, which, of course, is a sharp contrast with the US system. The other sharp contrast with the US system is that we spend from the public purse about 8% of GDP. There is another private and charitable contribution of about 1.6% of GDP. It takes us up to about 9.6% of GDP in England. In continental Europe, the proportion of GDP is more like 11%. It varies as between France, Germany, and parts of Scandinavia. And in the United States of America, it's over 18% of GDP. And one of the explanations for the difference between them is the rather fragmented system of care in the US. The difference between those who provide care and those who provide... Will you please let me finish? And those who provide health insurance... and also my own profession, which is the lawyers, who succeed in exploiting the difference between the two and with very large negligence claims. Nobody that I know would import wholesale the system of US healthcare, and indeed everybody I know in the US is struggling to find a way to bring it into line with something which is more socially acceptable, which is a collectivised model that we have in this country. You asked also about TTIP and the international trade deal. I have to confess that of all the responsibilities the government has conferred upon us, negotiating with other foreign states is not one of them. And the TTIP question, I think, has to be directed to the government, which has that responsibility, not to this board, which has no responsibility for international trade. I think that the... The third question, though, which really does take me and capture my attention, is about the relationship between the benefit system and the NHS and the role of DWP. And I'm going to look and ask whether Simon might be able to provide us with some further information on that.
Yeah, I think this is obviously one of the areas of the welfare state that is not working well. And one piece of evidence for that is that 300,000 people a year come out of employment and end up on benefits because of ill health problems that are not being properly supported through the NHS or through the kind of processes you're talking about. So I think one of the big offers that the NHS can make to the country is that by doing a better job in terms of our mental health services, our therapy services and other things, actually we will keep people healthier, we will keep them at work, and we will enable them not to end up on benefits. And at the moment, that is of no advantage to anybody. So one of the investments that is being made right now is improving mental health services for people with anxiety and depression. And there's this program called IAPT that is doing that. There's a lot more we could be doing there. And if we do, I think that will be a win-win for people and also for the country as a whole.
Is there any member of the board would wish to add anything on those questions? No? Well, then let's move on to the next batch. I'm sort of moving gradually back in this direction, but I'm going to move perhaps to the middle of the room. Madam with the pink top there. Yes, sorry, just wait for a microphone, if you wouldn't mind. Thank you very much.
Kim Sanders Fisher.
Kim.
Kim Sanders Fisher. I was trained in the US many years in American hospitals, in Jackson Memorial and at Johns Hopkins, come to this country and I've gone straight to the NHS scrap heap. Why? I'm a whistleblower. And I want to know when the NHS is going to stop squandering obscene amounts of money protecting the negligent at the expense of conscientious whistleblowers who are demonised for life.
Right, that's a good question. No. Thank you. We will certainly take that question on. Please, could I take a second one? I'm anxious not to overlook people. Madam, there are two ladies behind each other. The one in front's waving harder. So give it to the one behind her. No, that'll do fine. I'll come back to you, madam, with the next one.
Hate to say it's another American standing up.
This is fantastic. This is a global seminar.
The reason is because I've been here 44 years. The reason is I love the UK. It's because of the NHS. And I go back to the States all the time, and I say, you don't have what we have over here. And then I get so much heart problems in the USA of people who can't afford their health insurance. But that's not my question. My question is directed to the finance officer. It is to do with PFI, which is crippling the hospitals of paying back all these 30-year and 40-year contracts. On Radio 4 this morning, and we're discussing about there were several NHS trusts who have renegotiated. They paid off their contracts so they don't have to pay all these outrageous interests for the new hospitals. This is a new build of new hospitals. Why can't the finance director or NHS England make it mandatory that every trust goes back and renegotiates or the payoff their PFI contracts?
Okay, thank you very much for that. Paul, in due course, I'll come to you on that. And I did promise to the lady immediately behind you for number three.
Christine Mitchell, Chelmsford. This lady has just asked my question, but my problem with the PFI is when I saw what it meant, scam came to mind. I'm sorry. The PFI is a Tony Blair scam, and I want to know why it hasn't been investigated. Hospitals are hemorrhaging money. There's also another point. Why do we put off nurses and then hire agency nurses at a greater expense?
Okay. Can I take those questions?
Excuse me, just one more thing. One more thing. And this is all to do with cutbacks. MRSA. If we are all carrying it around, how comes it never manifests itself till it gets into a British hospital? And please don't tell me it's everywhere. I'm a retired coach driver and I've seen hospitals all over Europe. Very proud they've adopted a British idea, but they've perfected on it. Contrary to your belief, we are lagging behind German hospitals, Spanish hospitals, French hospitals. Our service is lagging behind.
Right, can I get an answer in due course from our chief medical officer and our chief nurse? Right, that was another three eventually. And I think that the first one on whistleblowing, in his first week as chief executive, Simon Stevens picked up the cudgels on whistleblowing, met a team of whistleblowers and has been working hard on that area. Simon, please, can you take us forward on that?
Yeah, I mean, the fact is that whistleblowers do the NHS a great favour. And for too long, whistleblowers have been ignored and harassed, and that's one of the reasons why we have asked Robert Francis to look at, with whistleblowers, what needs to change about the way in which, when frontline staff have got issues about the quality of care or other things they see, they can raise those concerns and that not get trapped and snared in all kinds of employment-related stuff, which all too often gets thrown their way. That's not to say that every whistleblower will always get it right, but it is to say that whistleblowing is a public service. And so Robert Francis is supposed to be producing his recommendation on how to protect whistleblowers in a way that goes beyond the limited protections that are in the Public Interest Disclosure Act 1999. And he's supposed to be reporting in November.
I contributed
to
that.
Great.
OK, well, thank you, and I hope Simon's response is reassuring. I see a number of yes signs up in the air. I wanted now to turn to PFI, two questions regarding PFI, and see whether Paul can help us on that.
Is my mic? It's still working good. So there have been lots and lots of reports about PFI, as you will all know. They've I think it's been extensively made transparent in terms of what the implications are. There are two main issues with PFI hospitals, one of which is that in some cases the financial deals concerned are simply not, were not good value for money. The cost is too high. The other is, in some cases, we've got hospitals which are much too highly specced, and therefore there is a kind of capacity issue in it. The fact of the matter, though, is that they are legally binding contracts which the government cannot simply rip up and move on from. Where there is a possibility of buying them out with value for money, and in a couple of cases I think that has been done, it will be done, where you'd have to give more money to get out of the contracts than it costs to keep them going, self-evidently we wouldn't contemplate doing that. But I don't see any other options.
To a contract that is not legal in the first place. Yeah, if you investigate further the beginnings of the PFI system, you will see it is a scam.
Well, thank
Tony
you.
Blair
thank
is going to be still waking up from it.
Thank you. Tony Blair,
I'm not answering for, but I am going to I am going to call on Bruce. Bruce, did you want to come in?
Is this on?
Yes, it is now.
Thank you for raising the issue of MRSA. I mean, it was a major problem. We've made very, very significant inroads into it, and we measure it really quite aggressively. And there are many hospitals now which are reporting long, long periods, over a year, without any cases of MRSA. But let me just tell you what my real worry is. My real worry is that globally, there is only one new antibiotic in the pipeline. And that around the world, antibiotic resistance is building up. And this is going to pose a major threat to all healthcare systems unless we can grapple with it pretty quickly. And that has become a major focus, if you like, of the chief medical officer in the Department of Health, and is being taken very seriously by the World Health Organization, this government. But it's just something that we need to bear in mind, because it could be a lot worse than MRSA.
Thank you very much, Bruce. There was a question also about nursing, agency nurses, which I, if I may, would ask Jane to answer.
Yeah, thanks, Malcolm. I agree. I think in the sense that some agency nurses can be useful at times if they need to be added to a normal set of staffing if you've got a particular issue or a particular patient that needs additional care. But I would express caution and concern if this was being done on a regular basis, and it is something that we will look in more detail to define and to report on, probably in more detail next year. So we are looking at it.
Thank you. I think Tim Kelsey wants to have a word.
It was just really on that point on whistleblowing. If I can go quickly back to it, I got into this job ultimately because my mother, who was a GP, felt she had to blow the whistle on a dangerous doctor in the southwest. That's where my journey started. My response wasn't just to reflect, as everyone has done, that it was vitally important that we make it easier for individual members of staff to blow the whistle, but equally that the service had to become massively more transparent about the quality of care provided. And one of the things I would like to just tell you is how committed we are as NHS England to proper, real transparency of quality in healthcare. And one of the things I think we should be proud of is the fact that already, right now, we are the most open healthcare system in relation to the quality of hospital care, for example, of any in the world. And that's because we do believe that we have a right to hold our health services accountable, precisely to hopefully reduce the number of people who need to make that terrible decision to blow the whistle.
Right, thank you very much, Tim. I'm going to take another three questions, if I may. The lady there had her hand up in the black top there. Laura, can you pass that along to her, please? Thank you.
I'm Maha Yusai. I used to work for NHS, and in 2012 I was sacked for whistleblowing. Excuse me if my voice is shaking, because I find it tough to talk about it, but I have a question for you. I was a proper whistleblower because last month I had a very good package and with an apology from the Department of Health. And believe me, I didn't want the money. It wasn't about money. The apology was the hardest came from the Department of Health, but that's the one I wanted. And I never signed any gagging, or would never sign any gagging, because I want to be here and I want to be asking you a question. The people who did what they did to me, still in power. they're promoted. I'm asking all of the board members, how could you allow that to happen? All I did, I put patient ahead of my own career, my health.
Okay. I will. Could I ask you a question? Was your employer a hospital trust?
No, I work. I'm one of the few ones. I'm a pharmacist. Work for a PCT, and probably you don't see PCTs whistleblower, but believe me, they're the worst one which cover up everything. And I worked there proudly for 15 years. But as I said,
okay.
Can I just say another question?
Is there another question?
Yes, there's another question. And unfortunately, that's a criticism of NHS England.
Is it a question, criticism?
It is, but it's a question. Why people get a job in NHS England without their job being advertised, without their come for interview, and why somebody like me can never get anywhere that kind of job? Because they already are for, what do they call it, for one of the boys, and I'm not one of them?
Okay, right. We'll come back to that one in a moment. Now, question number two. I'm conscious there's bits of the room that I haven't really been able to explore because there's a gentleman back there, you, sir, with your paper in the air with a green shirt. Sorry to have to identify you by your clothing, but it's the best. You, sir.
My name's Peter McLaughlin, lately of Banbury, but originally from Lancashire, you might be able to tell. My question is quite a simple one, and it's to Mr. Dodge. What can he sum his job in a few words, what it is today, and what it might be in 5 years' time?
Yes, that's okay, right. I think I will land that one on him in a moment, if I may. But let me take another one. Going back, lady there with the white top, I think. You, yes, please. Oh, I'm sorry, back of three rows. There we are.
Hi, thank you very much. My name's Caroline. I worked in mental health for quite a long time. I'm now in evidence-based healthcare. I'm really ecstatic to hear that there's going to be some standards introduced about access to mental health care. Mental health is quite unique in the sense that the criteria for needing treatment and recovering from an illness is quite poorly defined. An example of this would be anorexia, for example, where to get access to treatment, you need to have quite severe weight loss. It's usually the point where the illness has taken over to the point where it's very difficult to treat. And those patients are often discharged at a point based on their BMI, which is often when they're at their most vulnerable.
Caroline, you're leading up to a question, actually.
I am, yeah. This is when you get this revolving door, and I think that's probably quite common in mental health. So my question is that something that was raised today in the discussions, and will it be considered as part of the introduction to these standards about looking at those criteria?
Okay, thank you very much for that. I'll take these three questions. I think Ian Dodge deserves that first one about what his job is and what it will be. Have we a microphone for Ian? Thank you very much.
Thank you. Hello, good.
Yes, that's fine.
So I think my job is to try and help improve healthcare services and to help make sure that we end up with a sustainable NHS, a better NHS for the future. And I think actually that's true also of my fellow board members. How do I do that? It's by helping Simon and the board of NHS England develop strategy for the NHS. It is also, I look after, and I'm very happy to discuss this further, if you want more detail, the analytical teams within NHS England and some of the policy functions in NHS England. They include things like work on tackling inequalities, improving equality, helping with sustainable development in the NHS. There's a number of different specific things. And as I say, I'm very happy to discuss that further if that's helpful to you.
Thank you very much. I'm going to then to pass on to Simon the question, madam, about employment. And I think I will look to Bruce perhaps to talk about mental health issues. Simon.
Yes, I was... I was just trying to look up the website so I can give you the URL where we advertise all our jobs online, and it's NHS jobs, so it's www.jobs.nhs.uk, and that's where we post, to Maha's question, the jobs that we have in NHS England, with one principal exception, which is that when we were set up, a number of the staff that we took on were working in other parts of the NHS, and the agreement that we had with the unions, quite rightly, is that if people were basically doing the same job, rather than them being laid off and then having to start again, they would transfer over. So there was some of that went on, but for the most part, from now on, we are advertising jobs on that website.
Bruce.
Thank you. A good question about what we propose to do in terms of access and standards in mental health. So the three areas that we're looking to focus on at the moment, which have emerged through some detailed discussions and advice, the first is to get much quicker treatment for people who have psychosis. At the moment, they're having to wait far too long, and we're keen to really accelerate that. The second is to make it much easier for people to access talking therapies, which have been shown to be of enormous benefit to patients. They are very good value for money, and they help get people back to work quickly. And the third area that we're focusing on is to try and increase the amount of liaison psychiatry in hospitals. And that goes back to the remarks I was making earlier about, people often present to accident and emergency departments where their prime problem is with mental health, and to be honest, a lot of the staff there aren't adequately trained for dealing with that kind of thing. So we want to tackle that. You asked very specifically about eating disorders, and the area that we're focusing on eating disorders is in child and adolescent mental health services, where that is becoming a growing problem for all sorts of reasons that you can imagine related to social media and peer pressure and what have you. So we're doing some work on that at the moment. It is not being ignored.
Ladies and gentlemen, I've got an apology to make. I've just been handed a note that the BSL interpreters have to go regardless. And can I, on behalf of everybody, thank them so much for everything that they've done. Thank you both. That's been an outstanding. I'm really immensely grateful. We've run over time. I'm going to take three more questions and then it's drop everything. But three more questions. Livia has got... Yes, please.
Hello. Thank you for this. Can I begin by saying that I'm from Stafford, and when I hear Simon Stevens talk about NHS reconfiguration in relationship to Stafford Hospital, I find it profoundly disappointing, because we were told that we were put into the unsustainable providers regime after 10 years of extremely hard work, in which Stafford Hospital became one of the best performing in the West Midlands, and that reconfiguration in Stafford had nothing to do with the history of our town. And to relate those two is essentially to be blaming the people who were victimized, who were the victims of a poor healthcare 10 years ago. I think that was a very important point to make.
Yeah, but the question?
Okay, so after that, another person on the board, Kieran Devane, has been, as part of Macmillan, responsible for introducing the largest privatisation in NHS history. That's also happened in Staffordshire. There has been no public consultation, and our CCG have told us that they have no statutory duty to consult or to speak to the patients who are affected. I want to ask if that is what the board intended, and if that is acceptable to them.
Right, okay. Keeping an eye on time, I think it might be an idea if I asked for answers to those two questions. But can I then assure you that the board will be here after I've closed the meeting and happy to talk to everybody individually? So let me please ask, first of all, in relation to reconfiguration, Simon, is there anything that you would like to add?
Yes. Well, I don't think I actually mentioned the reconfiguration of Staffordshire Hospital at all. You may instead remember that actually I talked about talking to the relatives of people who'd been affected by poor quality care that was being delivered at Mid-Staffordshire Hospital, and which has been the subject of a public inquiry which has laid all the facts bare. So that's actually what I said. I did not talk about the reconfiguration. In terms of reconfiguration, though, I think the broader point is that actually what's going on is that in some cases we need to make health services more local, and that means not having centralisation of services. I personally think that we should see a bigger role in some places for local hospitals and community hospitals, and we've got to challenge some of the reasons why that is sometimes said to be under threat. But in other cases, we've actually got to be honest about the fact that unless we make changes, patients are going to suffer. And I'll give you just one very concrete example of that. Anywhere in England now, if you are riding a motorbike and you are hit by a bus and you come off, you will be taken by the ambulance, not necessarily to the nearest A&E department. You will be taken to an A&E department where they've got a major trauma centre. And the consequence of that is that 600 of our fellow citizens are now alive 2 years after this change came in, who would otherwise have been dead. So we've just got to sometimes be honest about the fact that unless we make some of these changes, care will be worse. But we've got to also make sure that when we are making these changes, we are very straight up about why it's occurring. Well, okay, so let's just talk about that. And I'm going to ask Bruce, because Bruce has actually been leading a review on emergency care, and what is being proposed is actually not a series of mass A&E closures across the country, but instead making sure that the major specialist centres have got the extra services needed in order to deal with this high complexity care. But, well, let's just listen to Bruce, because Bruce actually knows what he's talking about on this one, even if you think I don't.
Bruce, do you know what you're talking about?
Firstly, Simon's alluded to major trauma. There are two other areas where it's important that we get people to places where they can be treated properly. One is with heart attacks, because the science of treatment of heart attacks has advanced dramatically, and the second is stroke. And that constitutes about five, if you add all of those together, constitutes about 5% of the emergencies that are dealt with in our NHS. So we have shown a very dramatic reduction in mortality for heart attacks, which has been incremental over the course of the last few years, from 25%, as you mentioned, down to around about 5% now. And I think we've got a really good place in terms of international comparisons. And similarly in London, we reduced the number of places that would take people with acute strokes from 32 down to 8. And there were a lot of people who were concerned that if the ambulances went past somewhere that people would die en route, in the same way they had similar concerns about trauma. And the reality is that now we have a shorter length of stay for people who are admitted with strokes, a lower mortality, and more people returning back to independent living than before those particular clinically driven different ways of delivering the service. And furthermore, it's estimated that it'll save tens of millions of pounds. So what we've got to really focus on is how we deliver the best possible clinical outcomes to people who are sick, worried, and anxious, and simply want to get better. And sometimes that does mean changing the way we deliver our services. In the review, which I've been overseeing, which has been led by my colleague Keith Willett, who's professor of trauma in Oxford, we're quite clear. We're quite clear that people want services close to home. And for the vast majority of things that people attend A&E and walk-in centers and other things for, they can be dealt with close to home. And we want to encourage that, and we want to promote those services. But we also have to be absolutely honest about what the offer is, because there is a tendency to think that all A&Es are equal, whereas they aren't. We know that about one in five or one in seven of them doesn't have some very basic facilities that many people would consider are essential for an A&E. We also know that there's confusion over what a walk-in center is, a GP-led center. There are something like 22 different names. And what we want to do is we want to standardize the names. We want to be absolutely transparent about what the offer is in each A&E. And we also want to ensure that where specialist services offer a particularly good and better outcome for patients, the patients get to the specialist centres as quickly as possible.
Thank you very much, Bruce. Before I pass over to Kieran to answer the last question, I just want to express thanks on behalf of all of us. I'm passing over to Kieran in a moment, madam. But I just want, before I do that, to pass on our grateful thanks to the speech-to-text reporters and the graphic reporters. Again, I've run over time. It's my fault. It's not theirs. But please, can we thank them very much for the extraordinary work today. Kieran, your responsibilities wearing a different hat, but I think if you could give a brief account, then that will conclude the meeting. Thank you.
Yeah. The four CCGs in four of the five CCGs in Staffordshire, population about 750,000, they talked to cancer patients in Staffordshire, and they were told two things. One was coordination's rubbish. You know, you go into a hospital and you get bounced to a GP and you get sent to a hospice and you're back into hospital. So they said they wanted to do something about it. And the other thing they said was out of 750,000, if they get this right, there'll be 1,400 people in Staffordshire alive after a year who'd otherwise be dead. So they came to us with my day job hat on, and they said, actually, we want to make sure the patient voice is in the room. So this isn't just, you know, we know we'll get resistance from the local NHS hospitals or whoever about this, and we want to make sure the patient voice is in the room. So what they want to do is to stop managing 620 contracts and focus on the quality of care for their people. And what they said was they want to go to the provider, so the NHS hospitals in Staffordshire, and say, we will give you a contract, not 10 for 1 year, but we will give you one contract for 10 years, but you have to promise to play nicely with each other and get that coordination right. Now, there's no privatization involved. So what the issue is how do we get that coordination? How do we save 1,400 lives? How do we get the hospital and the hospice? I completely agree. I'll go in, I'll check that, because the CCGs are telling me that they're talking to the public a lot, so I'd love to talk to you afterwards and see what's really going on. So I'll happily talk to you afterwards, and you can tell me. It's really interesting because, you know, we know that there are people on the radio in Staffordshire. We know that there are people out holding public meetings in Staffordshire. So I'd love to understand, you know, what the issue really is. But 1,400 people will be alive after a year who'd otherwise be dead, and that's worth fighting for.
Right, thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, this has been an exceptional day for us, an exceptional day for the NHS citizens who have participated in our workshops. And can I say how grateful I am to everybody who's come tonight? And can I also say, I'll wear this with pride. Thank you very much. The meeting is closed. Thank you very much. Thank you.